Humber College, the best journalism school in the world, where dreams come true. And K&L Building, the best young journalism minds are hard at work putting together an annual publication, Magazine World. This is their story. Brian O'Neill, snail mail to email.
So far it's going pretty well. I'm writing on digital subscriptions and how in the last year there's been a severe spike in digital subscriptions. It was a little bit tricky at first, but so far it's been pretty well. Most people that I've called, they've been very supportive and they're very eager to help me out. Canadian House and Home was fantastic. I talked to them, two people, for at least an hour, and I got the hockey news. I talked for an hour. And they're very willing to give me my time. They're really excited about the project and really need to be able to communicate with the students. I'm kind of hoping for between like 1250 and 1500. Right now I'm about like 500 words more than that. But I figure if I put more, it's just easier to cut it as opposed to not having enough and then having to add on to it. And so I'm hoping to get back to the hockey news, take some photos of them doing some design work on the digital product. So hopefully I have that lined up for next week. I spoke to the art director yesterday, and she's going to run it through her boss now. Hopefully I'll be able to get something that looks better than just a straight, can you please smile for the camera? Thank you.
Espe Curry, Button Business.
My article's going pretty well. I'm waiting for some follow-up information, but I have the first draft done and I have all my photos. So I'm feeling pretty confident about it. I have all my sources. The writing is a little bit bumpy, I think. That maybe is a challenge. The magazine that I'm writing about, the editor was so helpful and gave me so many courtesy photos and really let me poke around in their office and take photos of everything that I wanted. So the photos actually turned out really well. I'm really happy about that. Is the easiest part of the whole article. My first draft was about 1,000, and I think it was barely anything of what I wanted to say, so I'm a bit worried that it's going to be pretty long.
John Rumley, Translating Politics.
Well, it's coming along. I mean, got a couple interviews done. I still need a couple more if I really want to do a really good story. You know, with a couple more weeks to do this, I think I could really pull in something good here. I guess my story is a lot more about policy and what kind of content people use. So I talked to Blake Lambert, a political science professor here at Humber. He had a lot of really strong opinions. I spoke to him for 35 minutes, and just deciphering the entire interview, I could write three stories about Canadian political magazines. The pictures are the hardest part, I'd say. You could write words on a computer and they just come to you, but getting pictures, getting good pictures, that's really hard to find.
Aaron Kenny, the magazine lady.
For my article, a lot of the fundraising is in September and October. So right now I'm just kind of relying on courtesy shots, and I'm also thinking about creating some arts or graphics for my article on my own, so we'll see how it comes out. The writing's coming along nicely. It's, you know, it's one thing at a time, and I think, my writing is based on the interviews that I take, right? It's the people that you talk to that formulate your how you want to put things together, so I typically build my articles on the information that I get, and you know, the better interview you have, the better information you have, the better your article is going to be. So I'm hoping it comes out nicely. You know, I'm learning a lot, but again, you know, the reason I chose my article idea was because I loved magazine fundraisers when I was younger, so I kind of have an idea of how they work, you know, what they do, how much fun they can be. So you know, it's just about kind of seeing where it's at now in the year 2013 and catching everyone else up on it.
Hermione Wilson gallivants downtown to meet the owners of Red Nation Online to record the interview for the MagWorld website.
In about 2008, I think, we started having a talk where I had this big idea of actually trying to do a print publication, sort of like a fanzine with maybe bigger aspirations to push it towards like a magazine look and feel, to which Rick quickly slapped me aside the head and said, why would you spend all that money and try to get all that revenue when you could go online essentially for free?
done with the interview. It went really well. I really like these guys. They were like the first interview I did, and they're really super nice and really interesting to talk to, so I was glad to see them again. And it was fun. Yeah, hopefully I can cut out my bumbling questions and just get their really eloquent answers, but it went really well.
Meanwhile, Adam Kozak, winner of Humber's Furriest Beard Award, had an appointment of his own.
Yeah, we're going to Money Sense. Going to see Sarah Efron and the intern there. Just take some pictures from my article on the internship article. That's the building right over there. And I got my camera all ready, so it should be good. Yeah, it went pretty well. Got some good pictures, I think. Sarah was really, really nice. Intern was great. I think I got some good pictures, possibly a new lead for my article. So overall, it went pretty well.
Back at Humber, we asked, what's the worst job at Magazine World?
Research chief.
Research chief.
Research chief.
Research chief.
Research chief.
I'm Kate Morris, and I'm research chief. My job was to read all of the articles, do a preliminary read of all of them, get a handle for what kind of facts were in them and what my section editors would actually have to do when they started fact-checking. So I wrote them each a short memo about stuff to look up for in the articles that they were doing, and I took a portion of the articles myself so that the section editors wouldn't be overwhelmed, and then the fact-checking began. For fact-checking, which Terry did explain to us, but no one really thinks about exactly how much work goes into fact-checking until you start doing it. You need to go through each article line by line, underline everything that is a fact, differentiate between fact and opinion, which is not as easy as you might think, pick out facts from quotes that need to be verified and how you can verify them, and figure out how you're going to get in contact with all the sources. It's a long process. You don't have a lot of time to do it, so organization is key. As you can see, I've got this big, giant folder. It also helps to keep everything in the envelopes, which Terry will give you. You'll have lots of USB keys as research chief and as a section editor, so make sure you hold on to them. People aren't happy when you can't find them, so having a folder definitely helps with that. Well, I can certainly differentiate between fact and opinion much faster than I could before. Emails are a godsend. As much as you need to do as much as humanly possible over phone, there will be people who are on holiday for the 2 weeks you have to do your fact-checking, so the only way you can reach them is through email. You also need to be pretty handy with Google. You need to be able to find secondary websites to verify stuff that you can't necessarily get from your sources. Numbers. Numbers are difficult. People have a lot of difficulty with numbers, no matter how much experience they have with them. Triple check any fact with numbers. You will be talking to Terry a lot, because there will be exceptions to every rule that you're taught about fact checking, where something just can't be done the way it was supposed to be. I actually think I might choose to do research chief again next year. I actually really enjoyed it. It was a lot of work, but I like research, so worked for me.
Then it was crunch time. The final dates for the magazine were set. Some of us were less than thrilled. The students had a chance to blow off some steam with a photo shoot.
Hey,
Sandra DeGrandis, the printing press.
Well, my best interview would have to be at Ironstone Media. I had two interviews there, actually. One of them was with someone named Kelly, and he was actually really, really helpful, and he was really enthusiastic, and it was interesting because before the actual interview got started, we just had a 20-minute conversation about life. He was actually really cool. He was like, oh, where do you go to school? What are you studying? What are your hobbies? And we're just like totally casual, and obviously I wasn't even recording it, so then we got into the interview, I'm like, okay, I have to record this because, yeah, it was really nice. It's probably one of the best, probably one of the best ones I had throughout, like from September to now, just in general. It's really, really good. I like it, and well, now that it's getting edited by a bunch of other people, we'll see if they like it. It's a learning point, right? I mean, we're not going to leave this class being great writers, but better than we were before, and I think that it's a whole learning process, and every year, every piece we write, every article we write, we're just going to get better.
Erica Villa, the award goes to...
My best interview is tough. All of my interviewees have been pretty awesome, but I have to say I had a really, really awesome conversation with Richard Johnson from the NMA's National Magazine Awards. He's been really, really cool. Like, we sat down at this little coffee shop in the Annex, and we were there for an hour and a half, and he was just telling me about NMA's, the National Magazine Awards Foundation, and all the details and what's coming and what I should know and what I should include in the article. I barely had to use any source information because he was the ultimate source. I wanted to tell the whole story, and I really had to kind of narrow it down and sort of find a more specific angle. And so I wish I could write more. I wish there is a way that I could make it a whole magazine long.
Caroline Brown, What a Hoot with Owl Kids Magazine.
The best interview I had was with Claire Green. She's the president of the Parents' Choice Foundation. She's just she's super animated, and she's really articulate, and she knows what she's talking about. Like, she knows kids, like, to a T. And, like, I think by the end of it, I had 20,000 words that I had transcribed. And so it was just having too much information makes it hard to actually put it into a, like, structured essay or a piece.
Danielle Strom, The Next Generation.
So I started on a topic about French magazines, and then tried to contact quite a few French publications in Ontario and Quebec, and had no response. I'm bilingual, so I tried both French and English, so it didn't really work out. So then I took over a topic from a classmate about in-flight magazines, and he had the same sort of luck, contacted a whole bunch of people within the industry, and no response. Tried quite a few times. Then I was on Pinterest one day, of all places, and saw that CBC had a new digital magazine called Generation Y, and thought, hey, that'd be a really neat magazine to profile. And brought it to the editors, and they said, yeah, that looks really cool, and got an interview with two editors and the senior producer in CBC. So at least one third time's the charm, and they worked out.
And, like, she had the different backgrounds and the different sacks.
I just feel
your,
like, eyebrow getting higher and higher and higher and higher.
Lots of laughs, lots of fun as the groups gathered for group shots. Xiao and Madeline were driving forces behind the magazine.
I'm Madeline. I'm the editor-in-chief.
I'm Xiao. I'm executive editor. I think we've gone with just the idea of Canadian magazines, how Canadian magazines work and how they survive when there's so much spill from the U.S. Because obviously when you go on a newsstand, most of the magazines you see in the front rack are American ones, actually.
Yeah, and I guess just how Canadian magazines in particular have adjusted to the evolving magazine industry and what they're doing to continue to push Canadian content in the actual pages of the magazine as well. I think working with everyone has been really great. I know at the beginning of the semester there was maybe a little bit of confusion or it was slightly unclear just who plays in what role, but I think it's come along really nicely, and I think the biggest thing that will determine how well we worked as a group is the final product, and I think it's going to be really great, so, but only time will really tell for that.
It's really smoothed out a lot. I don't think anyone doesn't know their roles at this point, and I can't think of anyone who's doing a bad job, quite frankly.
And we haven't had any major conflict. You know, there has been rumors in the past. There have been, you know, some confrontation or anything like that. But everyone in our group, I don't know if it's just a maturity level or the communication or what, but everything's been running really smoothly. No cat fights.
I can't imagine. Like,
I would say, at least being in, like, the executive team, I sort of thought we would have more involvement, but we'd be more hands-on, but I realize now that we have all of these different teams and we've got these managing editors that it almost makes us, we're more in a overseeing position.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I think I'd like, you. This is not a hand-holding project by any stretch of the imagination. The most important thing we can do is just set guidelines for people, set deadlines for people, and just check in with people and make sure that we all know what everyone else's expectations are and that we're all meeting them.
As spring sprung at Humber, the project progressed. Olivia Roger, the new look.
I was first having trouble getting interviews, mostly with the bigger magazines like Shadowline I could get in, and so I changed the focus more on designers and art directors. Well, I have a theme to my articles about redesign, so I tried to relate it to if you were designing your home. So I went to Canadian Tire yesterday and took pictures of the paint cans and got some paint chips, brought them home and did different things with them. But I really had to redo everything, so I started from scratch and I have a new lead, and now it kind of tells a story where before it was just bits and pieces. I still have a bit more work to do, but I'm a lot more happy with what has come out of it.
Benny Munoz, Hyperlocalized.
My best interview, they were all really great. I had two very memorable interviews. One with Caledon Living, where I spoke to the publisher, Katie Birchall, and her creative director, Simon Byrne. And then probably The G, which is a magazine from PEI. They were both really great, just because they took the idea of hyper-localized magazines and they really brought it home, made it their own. I would say I was a little over-ambitious at first, so I sent out emails to every small magazine in Canada, and so I had a bunch of them getting back to me and just being curious about what the article was, and then I had to sort of try and time manage, see what magazines could provide me with the best information and how to include most of them. So it was a big challenge to narrow it down and not repeat the same information. A lot of magazines obviously do things the same way, and I wanted to capture new approaches, and so that was difficult. I didn't want to cut any magazines out because I obviously appreciated the fact that they took the time to talk to me in the first place.
Kelly Townsend, the other side of advertising.
Yeah, just, I have all my interviews done, I just have to make it more interesting to read, because right now it's boring as sin. It's just about ads and advertising and magazines, and as much as the people in the industry, I'm sure would be fascinated by it. It's not that exciting of a read. But I mean, I did have good quotes. People I talked to were lovely, and they loved talking to me, because of course, I'm adorable, so.
During the final phase, the art team proposed flag ideas and sources of inspiration. Then it was done. After months of hard work, the students had a chance to see the fruits of their labor. Hugh Smith, Surviving the Lockout.
I really like the layout of my article. It's on the first draft we had kind of a rink outlining where the text would go in it, which is what I thought of originally, or what our team was thinking of originally, but it didn't really rub me the right way, so they expanded the picture of the rink to full page, which really makes it look a lot better. It was turning out better than I hoped.
We were all impressed, but what did the bosses think?
I think it looks absolutely awesome. I think it's very obvious that production and design put in a lot of hours to make it look as good as it did. And I mean, we're seeing it right now, so it's really good. It's a bit weird because it's like you're done, but you still have time and yeah, like another 2 weeks of courses. But it's a great feeling. So again, it's all down to production and design. Like they're the reason why we're done this quick.
Madeline shared Xiao's enthusiasm.
I'm thrilled. I'm so happy. I think it came out really nicely. I think it has a simplicity to it. I think it's something in the design. I really enjoy the clearness of it. It's obviously a text-heavy magazine. That's an expected thing because we all have articles in it, but I think the design team did an excellent job with the layout. You know, it's interesting working in groups like this because, especially being journalists, we all probably are really creative people and have our own opinions and our own thoughts for what we'd want the magazine to look like. So I'm so happy that we managed to come together and have something that we all enjoy. And there may be parts that someone would have done differently, but I think for the most part, everyone can look at it and say it's something that they're proud of. If that's one thing as an editor-in-chief, it's obviously to meet deadlines. And I am so ecstatic. I'm thankful that everyone met their deadlines. And I honestly think we pulled off a record here at finishing so early. And now we all get to enjoy the fruits of our labor.
After the writing, interviews, photography, and design were all done, there stood one woman who was still working away at one final aspect. The Magazine World website.
WordPress, well, it wasn't the first time that I was using WordPress, since I have my own blog and I have my own online portfolio, it was really easy using WordPress. It's really user-friendly, and I found the more that you fiddle around with it, the more that you play around, you get to know it better, so I'm very comfortable with WordPress now. Well, with the website, we only got the website around 2 weeks before we had to finish school, so pretty much it was crunch time for the online team, and we really had to, spent a lot of nights here. The other issue was the server kept crashing, but we had a great, we had a great online tech team that really helped us out, but it was really difficult just because every single time we would put something up, sometimes they might crash. It crashed a few times, so those are the difficulties that we had to overcome, was really technical issues. You know, we got down to editing video, we edited audio, we did everything. Working with Terry and Laura, they're great. They're honestly a really big help. They're excellent professors. They're willing to be there for you. They understand. They've done this so many times, too, because they've been here for years, so they've seen magazine after magazine after. Any single issue that could ever come up in a magazine, they've been through, they've seen, so they're really good in the experience, and they know exactly how to deal with anything that arises, so it was really great working with Terry and Laura. We just have a few articles that we have to change around, but other than that, I'm very pleased with the online product. It took in a lot of effort, a lot of work, a lot of long nights, but I'm very pleased. It's a website and a magazine we should all be really proud of.
So who is Humber Journalism? You see us as you want to see us, in the simplest terms, in the most convenient definitions. But what we found out is that each one of us is a writer, and a photographer, and a section editor, and a copy chief. Does that answer your question? Sincerely yours, the 2013 Magazine World team.
Given everything inside and out of